Valley's People, episode 10, duration 30 minutes, recorded 1st of the 11th, the replay TBA. Right.
Welcome again to the Valley's People. Today we centre in on the central coast of New South Wales to the Australian Reptile Park, because our two guests today come from Eric Worrell's Reptile Park. That's Mrs. Robin Worrell and Eric Worrell himself, but they have two different stories, because Robin is the only woman in Australia who can milk snakes and funnel web spiders, amongst other things. I'm going to see a little bit of that and talk to them both. I hope you can join us for what should be a very fascinating program. Thanks for joining us today. Our first guest is Robin Worrell from the Australian Reptile Park. Now, most of us would have seen the, 27-metre-long dinosaur, I think, outside the Australian Reptile Park. And we know of its existence. We know it's a very fascinating tourist attraction for people, not only from the Central Coast in Newcastle, but really right throughout Australia, and particularly in New South Wales. But the work that is going on there is also probably, as we examine it, even more fascinating. And Robin Worrell is one of those people that not only keeps the park alive for what it is as an attraction, but also contributes to the welfare of the country and people throughout the world socially by her particular work. And I think it is a fact that you are the only woman in Australia who regularly, shall we say, if at all, decides to milk venomous snakes and funnel web spiders, as one might describe it, as a living.
Yes, I think you would be right with that. I'm the only one who does it regularly, and with funnel webs, we've been working with them for probably about 15 years. So,
yeah, well, that fascinated me immeasurably, Robin. As a matter of fact, I asked around and I said, I wonder why Robin Worrell would have taken that on, and someone suggested to me that you really wanted to be a shorthand typist.
Well, I was trained to be a shorthand typist, and basically, if you're working with animals all the time and reptiles, you tend to want to know about them, and the more you want to know about them, the more interested you are in them. And of course, the automatic thing is to handle them and work with them as well. So it was an automatic step, really, a normal step for one to take.
I disagree with that. I mean, I can't see anything normal about starting wanting to be a shorthand typist and then looking at a row of venomous snakes and saying, ah, how fascinating, I must start
doing
it.
Well, I think basically you have to be interested in wildlife in general and then sort of realise exactly what purpose snakes and spiders do. Serve on the earth, and
well, in a nutshell, what is that?
Well, they tend to keep down all the other rodents. They keep down the populations of frogs and mice and rats and the smaller types of lizards. It's if you didn't have snakes around, you'd have an overpopulation of all those other creatures. Mm. And I'm sure a lot of women wouldn't like a lot of little mice running around in there. Their yards, not that they'd like a snake either, but
I don't think most people I know would like your job either, Robin, but it's a valuable job for science.
Now, it's a very rewarding job, yes.
Yes. Where are we at, shall we say, in the status of anti-venom?
There's still a lot to be done, a great deal to be done with anti-venoms, but basically there are anti-venoms now in Australia for all of the dangerous snakes in Australia, New Guinea and the adjacent islands. Plus, there's a polyvalent antivenom. That's one antivenom that covers all of the dangerous snakes, so that if the doctor's not sure of the actual snake you're bitten by, he will inject the polyvalent antivenom. But also, it's interesting that they do other... there's other things connected with the antivenom as well, like they can take tests now to determine the type of snake or spider you're bitten by taking blood samples from you. That's only a recent development. These are all sort of part of the actual work.
This must have been, you mentioned the word rewarding there earlier. I guess it was rewarding. You received the Humanitarian Award for your work for snake and funnel web milking.
Yeah.
And of course, funnel web milking, along with dangerous snakes or venomous snakes, has been something that's been part of Gosford, the Australian Reptile Park, for decades, hasn't it?
Well, Eric started the park in, originally at Ocean Beach in Yamana in 1945, and he's been working with snake and spider venoms ever since. We've been working with funnel webs voluntarily for about 15 years, 16 years.
Now, this snake venom goes worldwide, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It goes to all scientific institutions that require the venom. It's not just used for anti-venoms. It's also used for cancer research, blood coagulation research, lots of other facets of research as well. So it's not just the actual preparation of anti-venoms.
Mm. Well, I know someone said you're going to bring along some props, but I'm not quite sure what that means. We start talking about funnel webs and snakes.
I've got a mainland tiger snake with me today, and I'm going to show you how we extract the venom from it. This one actually hasn't been milked before, so if you'd like to watch me milking it.
Yeah, I'd like to watch you milking it, yes.
You can help
if
me.
You just describe the process for us.
Well, basically, this is the mainland tiger snake. He grows probably to about 5.5 feet. He's about the third deadliest in Australia. I'll just have to stand for a moment until I can get hold of him, or I can pin him there.
And it's quite happy if you just keep him on your side of the table, Robin.
All I've got to do is hold on to him. I'll have to do it on the...
Now, what we're seeing here simulates, does it, the regular milking process that you're doing?
Yes, we do this regularly, depending on our requirements for the actual venom.
He really wants to have a go at you.
Yes. If you watch closely, you actually see the venom coming into the beaker here. His fangs are on the top jaw, and you'll see the...
Oh, yes. Yes.
The venom. What we do is we don't prepare the anti-venoms at the park. We send the actual raw venom down to the Commonwealth Serum Laboratories in Melbourne, and they actually prepare the anti-venoms for snake and spider bite.
Now, what would that amount of venom, what would that do to you now, normally, without any...
Oh, it would kill you very easily.
Really?
If you didn't receive treatment. Depending on the dose, not necessary. It's probably about one person every 200 actually has a very severe reaction to a snake or a spider bite. Everybody else is treated quite successfully. But people who react, like, to bee stings or have asthma problems and things like that, they react very violently to stings and bites. Mm. They're the people you really have to worry about with this type of thing.
Well, I was going to ask you a couple more questions, but before I do, I'm just wondering, what are you going to do with your two hands if I ask you about the funnel web?
I'm going to put the snake down. And
how can you guarantee it goes that way?
Oh, it will. It just heads off in the opposite direction. They never really want to attack you, a snake, especially, you know, if you're walking in the bush generally. You'll never, very rarely, tread on a snake. They'll always tend to move away from you. The only time they will attack is when they're being provoked themselves, being hit at by us or whatever.
Well, how many times have you done that?
The milking?
Yes.
I've been doing it for about 10 years.
Have you been bitten at all?
Yes, once by one of these particular snakes, yes.
And what happened then?
I was very ill until I received the anti-venom, and after I received the anti-venom, I was quite all right.
Yes. What time would have to elapse before you could be saved with the modern treatment?
Well, it depends on your reaction yourself. They won't inject an anti-venom unless it's absolutely necessary, because the actual anti-venom, you can react to that more violently to the actual venom itself sometimes. So it all depends on that. But you feel a reaction to the bite within a matter of the blood circulating through the system within about 30 to 60 seconds.
I think I feel a reaction and I haven't been bitten.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll just let this one down now.
So that'd be tens of thousands of times, I guess, over that period that you would be picking up a snake like that.
Yeah.
Now, one of the more recent things, Robin, has been the search for an antidote to the funnel web spider,
isn't
it?
That's right, yes.
And your work in that is probably now recognised worldwide.
Well, we hope so. We have been, as I said, working on it for about 15 years, and there's been a lot of problems with the funnel web anti-venom. The male Sydney funnel web is the one that we're concentrating on, and his venom is much more complex than any other venom that the researchers have ever had to come across. I'll just get the funnel web for you.
Yes. Yes, as you do, it was just intriguing reading to learn that the sort of anti-venom process of snake bite really, statistically, has saved one person per day snake season throughout
the
world.
That's right, yes.
So without it, we could have...
I've got the funnel webs here. I'll just put them up on the table for you so you can have a good look at them.
Right.
I'll show you how we extract the venom from the funnel web. The male funnel web is much smaller than the female. They're always a definite colour. They're always a very boot-polished black. And
it wasn't until... it's only a couple of years ago, isn't it, since the breakthrough came?
Yes. The breakthrough came probably about 2 years ago, but the actual venom was prepared 12 months ago. Or a little over 12 months ago. I'll just tease the spider so you can
So you really have to get them angry first.
Oh, yes, you do, yes. But the whole problem is they don't like a lot of light. The funnel web will always move around at night time, or if it's been disturbed through the day, it will move around then, but they can't take any light.
Well, we have massive television lights working now. It would be against the experiment.
Oh, she's standing up quite well there.
There is a distinction between the male and female, is there?
Oh, yes. The female is much larger body size, but the concentration of the potency of the venom is not as potent as the male's venom. The male is much smaller, as you can probably see from
But more deadly.
But much more deadly.
Mm. Now, how do you extract the poison from that, the venom?
Right. What we do is that we keep the spiders in their jars, like so, and we keep them behind plastic, black plastic all the time, away from light. Then once a week we will bring the spider out, and we do everything within the one day. We milk it, feed it, and clean it within that one day. All we do is we have this pipette worked on a water suction apparatus.
Yes.
And we tease the spider so that the venom comes onto the fang.
I see. It releases venom onto
That's
the fang.
That's right, yes. It releases venom onto the fang, and we just lift the venom off the fang. And it comes into the pipette.
Ah,
and
through suction. And that's it's a weekly output?
Yes, once a week we do it.
Well, and they're put away again?
Yes, just they're like put away again and saved for another week. Wow. It's unfortunate with the male, it's rather interesting as well. When you tend to find male funnel webs, it's always after rain, never before rain, because they can't take dryness. But once they do start wandering, their lifespan is limited to about 6 months because they've already matured, and they've sucked up a substance in their palps to mate with females, and that limits their lifespan. So consequently, when you find a male wandering, he's only got a limited time to live anyway. So consequently, we have a very high turnover of male funnel webs, whereas with females, we can keep them for probably about 10 years. But with the males, we're very lucky if we keep them 6 months.
Yes, it does suggest just how significant that work of yours has been, Robin, down there.
Well, we know we need every spider we can get hold of, but with the dry weather that we have been experiencing, it's not been very good for funnel webs. Probably good for people, but not good for funnel webs.
We've seen the snake and we've seen the male and female funnel web today, but I believe you're into ticks and mosquitoes and luring octopus.
We've worked with most things. We've worked with wasps. The Commonwealth Hearing Laboratory, which is the government body that we work for, they approach us at all different times asking for peculiar things. At one stage there, we had to supply fleas from dogs. So we had to go around and ask the neighbouring people whether they had dogs and not to wash them for a couple of weeks so we could get an accumulation of fleas. And also wasps. We've gone out wasping at night time, you know, collecting paper wasps and all sorts of blue-ringed octopuses we're working on as well.
Yes.
About to make
the understatement of the year. What a fascinating job you have, Robin.
Thank you very much. I think it is too.
Robin Worrell of the Gosford Australian Reptile Park. We are inclined to call it the Gosford Reptile Park, but has Australian status, and in fact your work has worldwide status. Humanitarian award for your work in this anti-venom process. And we congratulate you and thank you for coming today.
Thank you for inviting
Robin
me.
Robin Worrell from the Australian Reptile Park, and we'll be back to talk to Eric Worrell, equally as fascinating, in just a moment. Welcome back to the Valleys People, and now to Eric Worrell. In fact, it's been inclined to be called Eric Worrell's Australian Reptile Park, which I guess is status for yourself, Eric, because it's your establishment, your creation, and your idea.
I think we'll have to start calling it Robin Worrell's Reptile Park.
Yeah, you know, there's one thing occurred to me in that. I can imagine people probably watching the program thinking that I was involved in a bit of gimmickry there, getting Robin to do that. But it wasn't gimmickry that we're after, you know, it was recognition, because Robin's work is such that people's lives are actually being saved by that now.
Well, she's the workforce. I only tell her what to do.
It's the right of any boss, anyway. But do we have any idea of just how many people are being treated with anti-venom over the last couple of years, Eric?
Well, the serum laboratories told me themselves that our work is saving one life a day during the snake's active period, which means I think about 20,000 lives have been saved from snake bite since we've been operating. Since they developed the funnel of venom and released it in July last year, there have only been two critical cases. There have been a lot of people admitted to hospital from funnel web bite, but only two critical cases where they administered the anti-venom and their lives were saved really dramatically. Papers are being written on these cases that they haven't been released yet.
Well, really, as Robin was saying, they tend to hold it back a little bit if they can to see what's going on.
No, well, it's not in big supply, funnel web anti-venom, but it is available everywhere where anybody is likely to be bitten by a funnel web. There are suppliers.
Mm. Yeah, well, the supply is coming from your enterprise. Mm. Makes it more fascinating.
Robin's work.
Yes, an MBE in 1970 for this work, Eric. I just wondered how it all began. You'd have to describe it as a most unusual industry, I should think, of the Hunter Valley and Central Coast.
Yes, well, I was very interested in all sorts of animals when I was five or six, seven. And then at about the age of seven, I realised how the ramifications that this could develop into. And I decided at that age what I wanted to do, and that's just what I'm doing now. So I gave away my stamp collections to my girlfriend and my cigarette cards and bottle tops and all the things I'd been collecting.
And swapped them for snakes.
Then concentrated on snakes. I did have a very good friend. My dad was a taxi driver, and on Sundays he'd take me out to La Perouse. And I met George Cairn, the famous old snake bloke now dead. And he'd just leave me there, and he'd go out and buy fish and all sorts of things like that. And I'd be there hour after hour after hour just watching this fellow handling snakes. And he became a great friend of mine. In fact, I only saw his son this morning before he came up here.
Mm. Well, why do some of your peer group say that Darwin is significant to you?
Well, I lived in Darwin during the war. When the war broke out, I was too young to join the army, but I was drafted into the AWC, and they taught me to be a blacksmith. So during the war, I was a smithy, and I volunteered to go to Darwin, and I served most of the war out in Darwin, and spent quite a lot of time there afterwards. And I found that it was a very fascinating place as far as reptiles went, and I was able to carry on my studies. I became a journalist then, a photojournalist, and worked for a number of magazines doing natural history articles, and I even went beyond the natural history. I did sporting articles and things like that.
You'd have to be about the only guy in the Australian Army, I guess, who applied for a leave application to go hunting reptiles. But it certainly paid dividends. Your other distinguishing mark is the fact that Eric Worrell is the most practical snake man in Australia, because no one really knows any more than you.
Well, I hate to say that, but I've had more experience than everybody else.
Yes, and you've written books on the subject.
All the other fellows who did this sort of work are now dead, and anybody who's doing anything with snakes now is born long after I started. So.
And what's the record of the Australian venomous snake, Eric? Do we have more than any other continent?
We have more dangerous snakes in Australia than any other place in the world. We have the deadliest snake in the world, that's the fierce snake. We have the second deadliest snake in the world, and that's a taipan. And at our park, we keep these, and we've also got the deadliest snakes from different countries, like the king cobras and common cobras. Common cobra kills about 20,000 people a year in India. We breed those. Well, you name it, and I think we've got it.
Yes. What do you do for holidays?
I don't know what you're talking about.
No, but I'm just wondering whether you just sally forth to enlarge the collection?
Well, when I sally forth, it's... Well, a working holiday. Robin and I are going to Southeast Asia in a couple of weeks, and we've been there about three times. Working out with people how to get hold of snakes and things like that to bring back for our collections, and studying the tourist industry and various things like that.
I read that you've been bitten many times. I wonder how many times.
No, that's a lie. I've only been bitten 6 times in my life.
Yeah?
And when you think, consider that I've been handling snakes for 50 years and I've only been bitten 6 times by a dangerous snake, well, that's a world record.
Yeah, what causes this incredible rate, you know, the number of successful, shall we say, pickups, and then what could be a potentially fatal pickup? What is the difference? Is there a difference?
Well, it's a matter of being careful, considering every movement you make with a snake. You notice Robin was very careful. She's only ever been bitten once in the 10 years she's been handling snakes. I've only been bitten 6 times in 50 years. And yet we've had employees, well, we've got one now who's been working with us for 6 months and he's been bitten 3 times already.
Mm.
It's just a matter of reflex action, being able to see when the snake is likely to bite and moving away. The snake is not faster than a human at all.
It could be a little sharper if the human is not just concentrating. Another thing that interests me about the Australian Reptile Park, Eric, is your work in animal surgery, or shall we say animal hospitalisation.
Yes. Well, we became a reluctant zoo. We started off at the Reptile Park in 1958 merely to produce snake venoms for the serum laboratories. But people kept thinking we were a zoo and they started bringing in injured animals and, deserted young animals, kangaroos that had been shot and the young were in the pouches, and we just started to look after them, and now we've got about 150 kangaroos. And we've got an animal hospital where we have a shift. I think we've got 3 nurses working in shifts throughout the week to look after them. They're rearing, well, last night, in the middle of the night, somebody brought in a baby frog mouth, and somebody else brought in a peewee, and then the kangaroos and the wombats and various other animals that are deserted or injured. So this is a constant job, and our own local Rotary Club donated $1,500 towards the building of this hospital, and we are getting donations from the public on this, but otherwise we do not receive any government grants or anything at all. We're a private organisation. We plough back everything we get into the park to develop it. We get 50,000 school children through a year sent by the education department. And, well, we're unusual. We're not like any other privately owned zoo.
Yes.
We're not a circus.
No, and that's for sure. Mm. I was wondering, Eric, in your own particular makeup, when you talk about the... Well, really, you don't turn any animal away, do you? I'm just wondering if you regard yourself as an extremely tender person in a sort of way.
Softy.
Softy?
Yeah. You can't turn an animal away.
No, it's sort of a line of softy. It's pretty hard with the sort of work of anti-venom, though, because which needs, I should imagine, very taut nerves.
Yes, well, it's a combination. Luckily, Robin is able to cope with the soft side and the hard side too. I call her the little woman. I look up to her. She's 6'1", and I'm only 5'8". And she'll look after anything at any time of the night. Go out and get it.
Yeah. Well, for all our sakes, particularly in the Hunter Valley and Central Coast, Eric, what's the export and utilisation of venom? What are we talking about? Where does it go?
Well, we send venom to every country in the world. We've sent it to Ireland. I hope they're doing the right thing with it. And England, America, we've supplied the American Navy, the English Air Force, Sweden, Switzerland, Russia. But we send venom everywhere. It's used in all sorts of pharmaceutical work, such as paralysing lungs for operations, same as the American curare thing. I suppose you've heard about that, the arrow poison that's used to paralyse.
Oh, yes.
Well, they're finding that they can use snake venom for that work too. They're using it in experimentation for cancer, blood clotting, and, you know, there's so many different things that has come up.
Yes, the significance of it's fascinating when you describe it such as that. And how do you get time for your other role of being author and filmmaker, and you're a foundation member of the Zoo Directors Association of Australasia? That's quite an honour, I understand.
Well, I'm the only private member admitted to it, the foundation member too. And they haven't admitted any others, any other private organisations since.
Yes. Well, I think that says a lot for you as a person. I think also perhaps it's recognition of the work that you're doing socially on all our behalf. And you and your staff, we congratulate. And thank you very much for appearing on today's program. Eric Worrell of Australian Reptile Park.
Thank you for having me.
Well, our guests today in the Valley's People, both from Australian Reptile Park, the Worrells. Robin Worrell and Eric Worrell. I think you may agree, two identities in their own right indeed. Robin Worrell, who is the only woman in Australia who would have a job such as milking venomous snakes and funnel web spiders. And Eric Worrell, the creator of Australian Reptile Park, which is doing so much for people throughout the world. I hope you enjoyed the show, and I hope too that you'll join us again when next we meet more of the Valley's People. Goodbye for now.